high ambiance. Mark 2, 1 through 4 definitely ties in with course, and I'm going to tie it in together. Amen. It reads, a few days later, Jesus again entered Capernaum. The people heard that he had come home. So many gathered that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came bringing to him a paralytic, amen, paralytic carried by four of them, since they could not get sick. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. So many gathered that there was no room left, and not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus, and after digging through it, lowered the mat. The paralyzed man was lying on it. I'm going to read it one more time. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. So many gathered that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus, and after digging through it, lowered the mat. The paralyzed man was laying on. Amen.
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 I realize over and over again, I see that people in the Bible, they actually take charge over their needs, over their miracles. And I believe that it goes for worship. We can't wait for the right ambiance. We can't wait for, you know, the smoke to clear to praise God. Because within that prayer, there's a miracle that's waiting. And I do believe that, especially the way that I'm surrounded right now, God is good because I know, you know, they're getting saved. As soon as I lift up my hands, you got the kids yelling and crying and screaming. You got everything around me kind of just going haywire. But I said, you know what? I'm lifting up my hands, and I can totally feel the shifting of the atmosphere. And I start praising God. I don't care.
Amen.
I don't even, you know, thank you, Lord Jesus. I rebuke that, and I just, the flow of the Holy Ghost is constant. I know my family, they look at me like I'm crazy, but I feel it. Amen. And so many people, at least in the body of Christ, they feel like they need, in order to in order to feel good, they need to feel God's presence immediately. And what God wants us to do is he wants us to enter into his presence.
Yes.
And that whole feeling, I want to feel God's presence. It's something that everyone's addicted to. Everyone wants to feel, but don't want to enter in even through all the trials and all the
confusions.
Controlled by feelings. Amen. And God has taught me, especially this week, to press through. Press through all the darkness and praise will break all that open. People will stop yelling. People will stop, you know, running around.
Yes.
I mean, God is good. I'm seeing, you know. I'm like, okay, you know what? All right. Thank you, Jesus. I give you praise. I give you worship. And I just start praising him.
Yes.
And it literally changes the atmosphere.
Yes, it
You don't
does.
Need to already have God there, which is lovely. I mean, sometimes I wake up and I'll feel the presence of God.
Amen.
And I used to be to the point where, what the fuck, I don't feel your presence.
Hello.
But now I've realized that I have to intervene. Sometimes you just show up and be like, we also have to get out of that fleshly desiring way and enter into His presence.
Yeah, where you can feel something, right, where you can experience the presence of God.
Yes, amen. Praise God. So, with that being said, let's enter into His presence.
One second, I want to tell a story that goes exactly what Sister Green was saying. How many of you are familiar with the great man of God, Smith Wigglesworth?
Amen.
He was called the Apostle of Faith, and he was from England. And very long story short, he was literally an illiterate plumber who couldn't read or write. But his wife got saved, and then through the same series of fighting against God, against your wife because you don't want to follow God, he ends up getting saved. And then supernaturally, God was able to teach him how to read and write. And he was taught how to read by his wife reading the Bible. So when he finally learned how to read without help, the only thing he ever read was the Bible. The only thing he would ever read the rest of his life was the Bible. Never read a newspaper, wouldn't allow a newspaper in his house. So Lester Summerall went to visit him with the newspaper tucked under his arm, and he looked and he said, "What's that?" He goes, "It's a newspaper." He goes, "Leave that rubbish on the porch." Wouldn't even let him in the house with the newspaper. Didn't allow anything around him but the love of God, but the love for the Word of God. Well, he was on a steamer, because they didn't have airplanes like they do now. They had them, but not the intercontinental flights like they do now. He was on a steamer to go from England to America, and steamers then are like steamers now. They party, and they had a contest one night in the dining room of like the amateur hour or America's Got Talent, and they still do that. They'll get people up to sing and perform and what have you. And they called him up. They didn't know who he was. The tour director said, "Come up here and sing." He goes, "Nope." He was real rude. He was real matter of fact. "No, sir, please. You look very, very handsome." He was always very dignified. He had told God, he said, "If I ever get holes in my shoes, I'll never serve you again." And he never paid for a pair of shoes his whole life. God supernaturally brought people brand new shoes to him all the days of his ministry. As he told God, he said, "The man of God shouldn't be walking around in worn down shoes. If I ever have holes in my shoes, I'm going to go back to plumbing." And he never paid for a pair of shoes his entire life.
Amen.
And always looked immaculate. He said, "No, come up here. You're a very distinguished man. Sing something." So he comes up, stands up there and says, "I'll sing under one condition." They said, "What's that?" "I sing what I want to sing." He said, "Okay." And there's like hundreds of people out there. They said, "Bow your wretched heads." And they all looked at him, and he started singing Amazing Grace. "Amen." As loud as he could. By the time he was over, everybody in that place was on their knees, weeping, and dozens came forward and got saved. He brought God with him. There was nothing there feeling God, nobody looking for God, but he entered in and brought God.
Amen.
Exactly what he said about praise. One man in the presence singing praise changed everything. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.